If you've been practicing meditation but been doing it in a different way, please let go of the old way of doing the practice and just do this. It doesn't mix very well, the old way as compared to what we're going to be doing. We're going to be practicing something that I call the six R's. Now, this is right effort. So it's real important for you to get familiar with what this is. The six R's are recognize when your mind has a distraction in it, where you're not with your object of meditation anymore. And release the distraction. The way you release the distraction is by not keeping your attention on it. This is real important. As soon as you release it, then you relax the tightness that's in your head, in your mind. That tightness is actually how you recognize what craving is. And as soon as you relax that tightness, you'll feel like an opening up of your mind. More alertness. Your mind is going to be much more clear, agile, and pure because you let go of the craving. Craving is the I like it, I don't like it mind, and I'll explain that a little bit later. As soon as you let that go, then you don't have any distractions in your mind at all. And you can observe with the pure mind. Then what you need to do is bring up something wholesome. And the way that you bring up something wholesome is by smiling. Now, smiling, a lot of people think it's just here. But smiling is in your mind. And this gets to be, as you go deeper into the practice, this gets to be extremely important. As you smile with your mind, you stop trying so hard. And when you stop trying so hard, then you can observe how mind actually works. So what the smiling is a kind of stepping back from whatever the distraction is, but stepping back with a light mind, with the mind that's clear and observant, but light, soft. As soon as you do that, then you bring that mind back to your object of meditation. Now your object of meditation is going to be loving kindness. And I'll get you the instructions in just a minute. And then you repeat staying with your object of meditation for as long as you can. Now these six R's are things that need to be done, not just repeat in your mind. Recognize, release, relax. You have to do each one of those, not verbalize them. And it's like rolling your R's. It's recognize, release, relax, return, repeat. And it's a flow that you start to get into of doing right effort. Now, when you're practicing loving kindness meditation, you first start by sending loving and kind thoughts to yourself. Remember a time when you were happy. When that happy feeling arises, it's a warm, glowing feeling in the center of your chest. Now, a lot of you don't, or this is for the people that haven't been here before. If you've already done a retreat with me, you'll start out by sending loving kindness to all beings in all directions, in the six directions, and then all directions at the same time. But for the beginners, start by sending loving and kind thoughts to yourself. Get that happy feeling going. Then, when it's going very nicely after 5 to 10 minutes, then you switch over to a spiritual friend. A spiritual friend is someone that when you think of them and their good qualities, you really like them. You sincerely do wish them well. Stay with the same spiritual friend all the time. Don't jump from one person to another person to another person. A spiritual friend is someone of the same sex, and they are alive. Some men have asked me if they could use the Dalai Lama as their spiritual friend, and my answer to that is he the same sex as you? And is he alive? But if you use the Dalai Lama, it's a little bit more difficult because you only know him by what you think of him and what you maybe see on the internet or something like that. But you don't know him personally. It's better to take a person that you do know personally, that you respect, and you sincerely do wish them well. A lot of women, when Mother Teresa was alive, they'd ask if they could send it to Mother Teresa. But it's better to send the loving and kind thoughts to somebody that you know. It's a little bit easier that way. And it's your choice. Now, your mind is going to wander. You're going to start thinking about other things. As soon as you recognize that your mind is thinking about something else, then you've already recognized that your mind is distracted. Release the distraction by not keeping your attention on it. Relax the tightness caused by that distraction. Smile, return to your object, to your spiritual friend, and continue staying with your spiritual friend for as long as you can. So it doesn't matter how many times your mind gets distracted. I had a monk that was practicing loving kindness meditation, and he insisted on trying too hard. And he was pushing to stay with that spiritual friend and not go away. And he was doing it way too hard. And he suffered for a long time because he wouldn't listen to what I was saying. The thing is with the meditation, if you follow the directions, this is fun, this is easy, and you learn how to let go of the suffering, to let go of the pushing and trying too hard. This monk was continually trying to, I got to be better than I am. I'm a monk. I'm supposed to be better. And I kept telling him over and over, there is no supposed to be. He caused himself a lot of suffering. And every day he'd come and tell me how restless he was. My mind won't settle down. Stop trying so hard. Smile. Laugh with yourself at trying too hard. Let go of supposed to be. My mind isn't supposed to be this way. Yeah, don't sit with your legs crossed. So, this is about learning how to be mindful. Isn't that a wonderful word these days? I just read an article about what mindfulness isn't, and I thought that was kind of cute. People are using this word as some kind of a catchphrase, and they don't have a good understanding of what mindfulness truly is. Everybody knows what the word is, but they don't know what the definition is. So I'm going to give you the definition that works in all different aspects. Mindfulness is remembering to observe how mind's attention moves from one thing to another. How does it move? This is important that you understand this. Because, like my little monk friend, he was trying to make mine be the way he wanted it to be, and he suffered a lot. And he'd become frustrated, and he'd even become angry, and he'd start accusing me of not giving him the right directions. And I gave him the right directions, same thing, every day. Fortunately, he was there for 3 months. He actually did start to pay attention. After, he stopped pushing. This meditation is supposed to be fun. I don't want to say supposed to be. It is fun. I want you to laugh, especially when you're caught by some kind of a hindrance that you know you're causing yourself some suffering by trying to force it to be the way you want it to be. Laugh at yourself with that. The fastest way to let go of an attachment is by laughing. You go from, I don't like this. This isn't the way I want it to be. To, it's only this. Now, do I want to hold on to this and make myself suffer or not? Let it go. So laughing and smiling and having fun is an important aspect of the meditation. So the more you can have fun with this and smile with how dumb your mind can be. We're all dumb. And it's okay to be dumb. Just don't indulge in it. Relax into these things. Stop trying to make yourself be a particular way. Observe what you're doing, how you're causing yourself the suffering, and let it go. The definition of mindfulness, what that does is it makes you go in deeper to see how this process works, because this is a process. This is a psychophysical process that we call ourselves. Now, you're made up of five things. Okay, you have a physical body. You have feeling. This is not emotion. Feeling is feeling. Feeling is pleasant feeling, painful feeling, neutral feeling. You have perception. Perception is a part of the mind that names the feeling. This is pleasant. This is painful. This is neutral. So perception is part of the mind that puts the mental name in your mind. You have thoughts, you have consciousness. What we generally try to do, and we're real good at these habits, is when a painful feeling arises, and we start wrestling, I don't want that painful feeling to be there, I don't like it, you start trying to think your feeling away. But thoughts are one thing, feelings are something else. Sometimes a feeling can arise and it doesn't go away right away. So what? It's only a feeling. Is it your feeling? Did you ask that feeling to come up? Did you say, well, I haven't been depressed or frustrated or sad for a while. I might as well do that now. No, you're not going to do that. Nobody's that dumb. It arises because conditions are right for it to arise. What you do with what arises in the present dictates what happens in the future. If you fight the present moment, if you try to change the present moment, if you try to make the present moment be the way you want it to be, you can look forward to suffering a lot. And it's your choice. That's what I told that monk every day. Why are you doing this to yourself? Why don't you learn and stop trying so hard? As I said, eventually he did. But he caused himself 6 weeks of pain. Now, the progress in this meditation is going to be fast for you if you follow the directions. Don't add anything. Don't subtract anything. If you've been doing meditation for a long time, sometimes you're going to get caught by not doing the six R's, and your mind is going to slip into a kind of one-pointed concentration. When it slips into a one-pointed concentration, you'll get very blissful. You'll get really happy as long as you have that one-pointed concentration. But when you get out of that, then the hindrances are going to come big time. And you're not going to like those. And you're going to wish, oh, I wish I could get back into that beautiful state. The six R's are let me put it this way. The Eightfold Path is all eight folds that are equal. But right effort is the first among the equals. Right effort is the thing that if you follow this and practice it without resistance, without trying to change it, without trying to make it any different than it is, it will lead to extreme happiness and suffering will stop. So, now sometimes there are people that they have a secret. They have something that happened to them in the past, and they don't want to tell anybody about it. But it keeps coming up in the meditation. What is a secret? A secret is where I am, and I'm not going to tell. I am so embarrassed, or I'm so hurt, or I'm so whatever it happens to be, that I'm not going to say anything. It will keep coming back over and over again until it just doesn't matter to you anymore. You let go of the secret. And once you say what the secret is, it's not a secret anymore. There's a lot of relief in that. And we all carry these secrets around with us. And we cause ourselves a lot of pain. Because that's me. That's mine. That's who I am. When in fact, nothing is yours personally. Everything is impersonal. And as you start to soften and let that go, it'll sometimes go away by itself, but sometimes you need to say it. So, we cause ourselves immeasurable amounts of pain. The Buddha said that we've cried so much in our existences that we could fill up the entire ocean just with our tears of the pain we caused ourselves, of the sadness that we took as, this is my sadness, and I'm not going to tell anybody why it happened. So what we have to do is be able to recognize that we're doing this to ourselves and keep softening, keep relaxing into it. Keep using the six R's. The six R's will take you to arahatship. I haven't been able to prove that quite yet. I have a lot of students that are very close. And we'll see what happens in the future. The whole point of doing this meditation, the reason that you're here, is so you will change from the old way of doing things that causes pain to a new way where there is no more pain. Letting go of that suffering. That depression, that sadness, whatever it happens to be. And this is too simple. It's too simple to let go of this stuff. That's what a lot of people tell me. It can't be this simple. Just recognize that you're distracted, release the distraction, relax, smile, return. That's too easy. It's not always easy. But it is that simple. When the Buddha started out teaching people meditation, if he would have started teaching you some kind of complicated system that was slow to get progress, how many people do you think would have followed him? But today, we have so many different methods of meditation. And I have friends that have been practicing for as long as 50 years. 50 years doing the same practice and not really progressing. Still having the same hindrances that when they started was a big problem. Now it comes up, it's not such a big problem, but it's still there. Why is it coming back over and over and over again? Because you're not doing the meditation and letting go of craving. One pointed concentration is reasonably easy. You're on your object of meditation, your mind gets distracted. You let go of the distraction, immediately come back to your object of meditation. What are you doing when you do that? You're bringing that craving, the cause of the suffering, back to your object of meditation. And you get so good at it that the force of the concentration stops the craving from arising. You haven't let it go. You haven't purified your mind. But you've suppressed it for a time being. So what we need to do is just add this one extra step. That relaxed step. So that you never go so deep that it's suppressing anything. Everything in Buddhism is about doing this. Opening up. Allowing it to be. It's not yours personally. Doesn't matter whether this stuff comes up or not. What matters is what you do with it when it comes up. If you start to tighten around something, whether it's a thought or a memory or whatever, if you start to tighten around it, you can look forward to that coming back again and again and again. Like one of my friends, 50 years, he's had fear. He's really afraid every time he gets in front of an audience to speak. And you can hear it in his voice. But he gives a heck of a good Dhamma talk. Some of it's quite brilliant. The thing that he's not seeing is that tightness. He recognizes that fear is there, but he doesn't know how to let go of that. He's learned how to accept it, so it doesn't bother him so much. But you can still hear it in his voice when he gets up in front of a big crowd. And that's 50 years of practice that don't lead to the end of suffering. The whole point with this meditation is learning how to recognize these things for yourself. You are your own teacher. I'm not your teacher. I'm a guide. I'm just going to keep you on the path as best I can. And sometimes I have to work really hard, like with this monk. Every day saying the same thing over and over and over again. Do you understand how much patience I have? And I'll do the same for you. If you get caught and you insist on keeping that secret and not letting go of the identification with that feeling, then I'm going to keep pestering you until you do. And you'll get tired of hearing me say the same thing over and over again. Is that all this monk knows how to say? Can't you come up with something new? So it's a real interesting process that you're teaching yourself. You're teaching yourself how to recognize the little subtle movements of mind's attention. How did that happen? What happened first? What happened after that? When you start to get good at recognizing how this process works, in other words, when you get good at becoming mindful, you start seeing more and more clearly how this process works with everything. That's called dependent origination. And you'll start to recognize more and more clearly how this process works, and you're going to have a lot of, oh, wow, a lot of them. So, it all comes back to staying with the six R's. Every time there's a distraction, I don't care if it's mental, I don't care if it's physical. Now, one of the things that happens as you go deeper in your meditation is you'll start to be able to recognize meditation pain. What's a meditation pain? It's a pain that arises and it's really there and you think, oh man, I can't stand it. And you get up and you start walking and it goes away in 1 or 2 minutes. That's a meditation pain. Real pain doesn't go away. I don't want you to sit in that same way if the pain gets aggravated. But the thing with meditation pain is it is 100% mental, even though you feel it in your body. It's a mental pain. It is a hindrance. That's one of the ways hindrances arise. So after you are able to recognize that is a meditation pain, I want you to sit with it longer. Who doesn't like it? Who wants it to go away? Who wants it to stop? I do. This is mine. Oh, that pain in my back is so bad. Or my pain in my buttock, wherever it happens to be. Oh, I just can't stand it. Well, who's got an attachment? I do. Who doesn't like it? I don't. Who wants it to go away and stop bothering their meditation? I do. See how easy it is to get caught in this sort of thing? The hindrances can sometimes be very, very subtle. Because it jumps up at you and it's your mind knows where all of your little tricks are. Where all of the buttons are. and it'll push them. But as you get more and more balance in your mind, equanimity, and accept the fact that these things are there, you'll get to a place that's called disenchantment. Now, disenchantment is a finer degree of equanimity where you get disenchanted with everything. Food, even your favorite foods, you'll look at it and go, yeah, that's food I need to eat, so okay, we'll eat some. But you don't get excited by it anymore. Now, that degree of equanimity is very close to being able to let go of the suffering. Don't try to make your mind disenchanted. Doesn't work. This monk can tell you that. But your job is simply to observe. And I want you to tell yourself, every time you sit, I'm not supposed to be doing anything except observing. That's all. It doesn't matter what comes up. It doesn't matter whether you like it or don't like it. It doesn't matter whether it's painful or pleasant. Your job is only to observe and allow it to be there. Because it's not you, it's not yours. It is an impersonal process. Recognize it as that. Allow the space for it to be the way it's supposed to be. Don't try to make it any different. But I don't like that feeling. I don't care. The more you can allow these things to be without getting involved with them, without trying to control them, without trying to make them be something else, the easier the meditation becomes, the more fun the meditation becomes. Don't be afraid of letting go. Don't be afraid of allowing painful things to happen. We all have painful things that happen in our lives. And it's got to be okay for it to happen. Because it's there. Don't fight with the truth. Don't try to change the truth. Allow the truth to be. And sometimes that pain will go away real quick. Sometimes it won't. It doesn't matter. What you do with that, that's what matters. You accept the fact that the pain is there and it's all right for it to be there, and you don't fight it and you don't take it personally and you don't keep your little secret. You let the secret go. You will feel relief. I promise. That's the whole point of doing this. Letting go of that little tiny, sometimes subtle, sometimes huge attachment. What is attachment? I am that. That's what all attachment is. I'm taking it personally. I remember when I did this, when I was growing up, and it was really repulsive. And I caused a lot of pain, not only to myself, but to someone else. Okay. So what? It doesn't matter that you have that memory come up. You have to accept it, allow it to be there, and let go of the guilty feeling of whatever that action was. That stuff that happened in the past, that's just part of a dream now. So why hold on to it? Why feel guilty about doing something that was not so wholesome? Well, join the human race. We've all done stuff that's not so wholesome. In how many lifetimes have we wound up killing other people or causing extreme pain to other people? Well, but I shouldn't have been like that. Who shouldn't have been like that? It's only a memory. Let it go. Relax into it. Forgive yourself because you made a mistake. Because you didn't understand. Because you got caught up in an emotional snit of some sort. Okay, so what? Can you forgive yourself? Forgiveness is a big part of loving kindness. A big part. And forgiving yourself because you made mistakes, the forgiveness cuts through that guilty feeling, so you don't have to be guilty anymore. Yeah, you did it. Yeah, it caused pain. Yeah, I killed somebody in a past lifetime. Well, we all have. And it's okay. It has to be okay. Because it's already done and gone. It's the guilty feeling that you hold on to that causes your pain. So, forgive it. Forgive yourself for just doing whatever it is that you can you remember that you did. And sometimes you forgive something that you don't remember. I forgive myself for making a mistake, for not understanding, for causing pain. When you use the forgiveness as a tool, that is the fastest way to let go of the guilty feeling. That will stop you in this lifetime. Your mind will tell you when you have forgiven enough. Okay? There's a lady in Malaysia right now that when she was born, her mother was not married, so they put all the blame on that onto the baby, and they treated the baby very cruelly, and her whole life has been a series of nightmarish things happening to her. When she came and she started practicing the forgiveness meditation, she could not walk. She could barely speak. I just got an email from her day before yesterday. She went out for a walk for a mile. She started forgiving her father for being cruel, forgiving her mother for being cruel. They sold her when she was real young, and she was treated like a slave. And she forgave those people for being cruel to her. She's gone through major personality change that's affected her body in a very positive way. And she's actually starting to smile. That's not easy for for some people. All of these things that happen to her, it's real easy to take them personally and hate them. But who's causing themselves pain? Who's causing themselves all of this suffering? Want to let go of it? Let go of the hard feeling of making mistakes. I don't know of anybody that's ever lived that hasn't made a mistake at one point or another. So, we all need to learn how to forgive, how to allow the past to be the lesson. And forgive yourself. Yeah, I screwed up. No doubt about it. Caused myself all kinds of problems because of it. Can I forgive myself for doing that? Or forgive another person who I want to blame for causing my suffering? You cause your own suffering. You can't blame anybody else. She learned this lesson. And she did it in less than a month. She's in her 70s. She's had a whole lifetime of excruciating pain. She has scoliosis, where there's this curvature of the spine that causes all kinds of problems. That's starting to straighten out. It was caused by her dislike of the situation, her guilty feeling, her doing things that cause pain, not only to herself, but somebody else. So, The real thing is, the more you can forgive these kind of problems, the easier it is to be happy. Oh, we're still talking about happiness. Isn't that odd? Letting go of the identification. You made a mistake. Okay, so? Welcome to the real world. We're going to make mistakes. That's how we learn. What you need to do is recognize, yeah, that didn't work. I'm not going to do that again. Because you know it doesn't work. It's having the awareness not to get caught in doing the same thing over and over and over again. The same painful thing. That's the lesson that this monk learned. And he was trying to blame everybody but himself for his pain, for his restlessness. Finally, he let it go. And when he did, wow, amazing personality development happened by itself. Because of that push that he thought he had to have. And he started backing off and backing off. Oh, I have another person that just left three or four days ago. He'd been at the meditation center for a month. Oh, I've got this headache all the time. Stop trying so hard. But I've got this tightness. Stop trying so hard. Stop trying to control. You've made mistakes in the past. Forgive yourself for the mistakes. Continue. This meditation is about change. Letting go of the old ways that don't work. Develop new ways that are much easier and better, and they do work. Stay with your object of meditation. Use the six R's every time there is any kind of distraction. Stay with your object of meditation while you're walking. while you're eating, while you're taking a shower, while you're going to the toilet, stay with your object of meditation. Use the 6 R's whenever there's distraction. Remember, mindfulness is to remember to observe. And you're going to forget sometimes. You can't criticize yourself if you forget. Okay, I forgot. Well, I was going along real good there for a couple hours. Now I got to use the 6 R's again to get back in the flow. You can't criticize yourself because you forget. This is a game. Make it a fun game. Don't get caught up in, I'm just not doing it right, and get frustrated and become angry with yourself. What is harmonious communication? Harmonious communication, part of the Eightfold Path. How much do you criticize yourself? How much do you beat yourself up? How much are you taking personally because I'm not as good as I think I should be? How much pain are you causing yourself because you don't accept yourself for the way you are? You're not going to be perfect. And it's okay not to be perfect. Learn from, well, it didn't work that way. Let's try something else. Let's try something new. And see how that does. And if that doesn't work, okay, let's try something again. Don't be afraid to experiment, but experiment with the 6 R's. Allow it to be. Relax into these things and see if it works. Okay? Sit no less than 30 minutes. That's the bottom line. 30 minutes is the least for your sitting. When your sitting gets good, sit longer. Now, I've had some people that were truly amazing meditators. Truly amazing. This man in Indonesia came to me. Never done any meditation before in his life. First time. He really took the instructions to heart and he practiced them. His first sitting, 4 hours. Never having done a retreat before, never having done any kind of mental development before, he sat for 4 hours. Nobody's supposed to be able to do that. So he was moving along in his progress, so I said, okay. Came next day for his interview. How long did you sit? 11 and a half hours. No, nobody's supposed to. Nobody can do that. The second day of a retreat? 11 and a half hours? So I questioned him very intensely about what he was doing. And he was doing it right. And he wasn't giving in to the meditation pains. He was just sitting through them. Had this equanimity. He was brilliant. The third day he came in. How long did you sit? 11 and a half hours. I'm starting to get used to that idea. I don't like it very much. What time do you go to bed? Or what time do you get up? Oh, 1 o'clock in the morning. And I'd see him 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon. He'd been sitting all the time. Not breaking for breakfast or lunch. Not going to the bathroom even. He just sat. he became a sotapanna. He became the first stage of awakening in 3 days. Can it happen for you? Yeah. Do you have to sit that long? Not necessarily. Do you have to use the 6 R's and let go of all the distractions and not take it personally? Yeah. By the end of a 10-day retreat, he got to the third stage of awakening. It was pretty amazing. He came to a retreat the next year, his first sitting. I said, how long did you sit? 15 hours. Wow. But he had this understanding of what he was doing and how to use the 6 R's. So when he got off retreat, I said, okay, now I want you to sit for 2 days. Don't move. He said, okay. And he did it. That's impressive. Real amazing. That can happen. You never know when your mind is going to all of a sudden understand and let go of the attachments. You never know when that's going to happen. Puneji came this summer and we got into a discussion. Have you seen the video of that, of our discussion?
I have. There are 2 parts to it.
Yeah. But he was starting to say that you can't attain Nibbana if you just get into the first jhana. And I showed him in the sutta where you can't. It can happen at any time. While you're doing anything, all of a sudden your mind just says, okay, you've used the 6 R's enough, now you get into the space where there's neither feeling or perception or consciousness. And when you come out of that, you see the links of dependent origination. And you do become a sotapanna or a sakdagami or anagami, whatever it happens to be. So you never know when your mind is going to let go, when you've used the 6 R's enough. Don't take anything in this world personally. Everything is part of an impersonal process. All of your thoughts, all of your feelings, all of the sensations, everything that happens to you is part of an impersonal process. And it's okay for it to be happening when it happens. It has to be okay, because that's the truth. What are you going to do with that truth? That's the question. Fight with it, resist it, try to make it different than it is. You can do that, and you can cause yourself a lot of suffering. Or you can accept the fact that this is the way it is, that life is. It's okay for it to be that way. Allow it to be that way and back off. Yeah, it's not mine. I didn't ask this stuff to come up. It's coming up all by itself. It's okay for it to be there. Relax into it. Okay, I've been talking for a long time. Whatever your object of meditation is that you're using when you're sitting, use that object of meditation while you're walking. Stay with your object of meditation all the time. Okay? It's pretty easy instructions, right? Do you have any questions? Oh, this is not good. You mean I told you everything that you had, I might as well go home. You don't have any questions, what am I here for?
You want to talk about walking a little bit more? That's usually...
I want you to walk at a normal pace. Don't walk slowly. That was my problem. I walked slowly, I sat for long periods of time, and I've had 20 years of swollen ankles because I got blood clots. And yes, I forgive them all the time. But walk at a, you're walking to get exercise, to get your blood flowing. Sometimes I have people running up and down stairs because I want you to get your blood flowing. If you walk slowly, it takes a long time for the blood, when you're sitting, the blood goes down into your legs. You walk slowly, you're not getting much exercise. And exercise is an important part of the practice. Another thing that's an important part of the practice is drinking water, as odd as it sounds. Yeah, but it's cold out. I don't need so much water now. Yeah, you do. You put more oxygen in your system when you drink more water. And it does affect your meditation, especially when you start sitting longer. You sit for 3 hours, 4 hours like that. You need to get that water into your system. And you need to get exercise. When I was practicing Mahasi style meditation, I was walking very slowly and I was doing everything very slowly. And I don't see any real advantage to that. Moving slowly does not help you with your daily life. But moving at a normal pace, that will help you. And sometimes even moving faster. Some people come to the center and they say, can I go out jogging? I don't recommend jogging because it's hard on your body. I tell them to go up into the mountains. There's a couple of places that you can walk where we are that it gets your heart beating pretty fast. You know, tromping around in the rocks and stuff. But you're walking for exercise. Mahasi Sayadaw in Burma, they made him a hallway to walk in. Okay, it was like 8 feet wide, and it was about 30 feet, 40 feet long, maybe a little longer. And when he did his walking meditation, he was walking at a normal pace. But all of his teachers told everybody, you got to walk slowly. He didn't. Walk at a pace that you're comfortable with. When you sit longer, walk more energetically so that you start breathing through your mouth. Hopefully the weather is going to be nice so you can be doing that outside. But walk no less than 15 minutes. And if you're running up and down stairs, they don't really have many stairs here to run up and down.
We have the stairs to the dining hall.
Yeah, but that's not many.
Well, we have this mountain out
there. Yeah, that's it.
They can walk up there.
Yeah. But stay with your object of meditation while you're doing it. See, the thing that a lot of people really don't understand, they think walking is not part of meditation. And there's no part of your life that's not meditation. That's why I wrote the book. He didn't agree with the title when I gave it. Life is meditation. Meditation is life. There's no aspect in your entire life where you can't use the six R's and let go of the things that cause you suffering. There's no part of your life. Keep your meditation going no matter what you're doing. If you have a yogi job in the morning, stay with your meditation. Keep watching. Smile into everything. Smiling helps your mindfulness to improve. Keeps your mind light. Do you see yourself getting serious about something? Who's got an attachment? Who doesn't like it? Who wants it to be different than it is? There's no part of your life that's not meditation. Remember that. It's important. Get into the habit of watching how mind's attention moves from one thing to another. Life is supposed to be fun. But we get so serious with ourselves, and we beat ourselves up so much of the time, and we don't meet our own expectations, so we don't like that, so we start putting in wrong effort and causing ourselves even more pain. We got to stop doing that. We got to start recognizing that this is fun. I have a great time. I laugh a lot. And I have animals that like to play tricks on me to make me laugh. You can't believe. So, please stay with your meditation. Stay with the six R's as much as you can remember. Be nice to yourself. Don't be trying to push yourself. I'm supposed to be better than this. I've been doing this practice for so long. Where am I? Who has an expectation? Who's causing themselves pain? Smile. Have fun. Laugh at how crazy your mind is. Okay? Don't let any part of your time here be without 6R-ing. 6R a lot. Now, tomorrow we're going to start talking about keeping your noble silence. Cut down on your speaking. not only to other people, but to yourself. Be kind to yourself. You're not going to be perfect at this. You're going to make mistakes. Okay. Just don't do the same mistake over and over again. You don't learn if you don't make mistakes. So it's real important for you to understand that, yeah, you're going to make mistakes. You're not going to be perfect. There is going to be some suffering around. So, it's not yours anyway. So why take it personally? Why fight with stuff? Why not relax into everything? Any other question? The big silence. You understand perfectly what you're doing. Okay. You know, one of the things that the Buddha said about people that don't ask questions, said you're going to be reborn stupid. I had a teacher that had more patience than I do, I think, because I was continually asking him questions. And now, some of my students are continually asking me questions. But that's how you learn. If you're unsure, there is no such a thing as a stupid question. So if you're unsure about anything, please don't be afraid to ask. Okay? So why don't we share some merit? May suffering ones be suffering free and the fear struck fearless be. May the grieving shed all grief and may all beings find relief. May all beings share this merit that we've thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. May beings inhabiting space and earth, devas and nagas of mighty power, share this merit of ours. May they long protect the Buddha's dispensation. Sadhu.